what is that? What's that food? Yeah, I don't know about y'all. I love Nicole and Rambo being up there with someone else. It's like they're awesome. It's like a breath of fresh air every week. It's just helpful. They scared us this week, though. That's a little crazy. And one of the things that they mentioned that's coming up very soon is high school retreat. High school is real. It's not high school retreat. It's just worried. I want you guys to sign up and register for this retreat that we have coming up. It's always one of my favorite things that we do all year, where you get to be really intentional about your relationship with Jesus, and you get to dive deeper and learn some new things. And so make sure that you guys register for that. It's only $10 for the deposit to hold your spot. So make sure that you guys sign up tonight. Go ahead and get registered so that it is not filled up. Cool, we got it. So we're going to go ahead and continue our series, Fix Your Focus. If you were with us last week, we talked about fixing our focus on heaven. And we talked about how, in order for us to live the life that God has called us to live here on earth, we actually have to think about the life that we're going to live after earth and in heaven and with our eternity. So tonight, I want to continue our series, Fix Your Focus. We're going to dive into some scripture. I'm so excited to dive into one of the parables that Jesus tells us about in scripture in just a minute. But before I do that, has anyone ever met someone who's just really sentimental about some junk? Maybe some stuff we maybe some other people a hoarder. Anybody know what hoarders in your life? Maybe if you don't know what a hoarder is, I have a picture taken on a TV show about hoarders. Now this is an extreme case, but we see if you've ever seen this show, you see this is their house. This is where they live. This is them chilling. We have another picture here. Where it's even gone into their bedroom where you can't see the floor, it's piled up to, I would be scared that this is going to fall on me if this was my bed and I was trying to sleep. I wouldn't take that off, but just to give you guys a little picture of what a hoarder looks like. A hoarder is someone who holds on to something that doesn't really have value to anybody but them. Someone that holds on to something maybe a little bit too long, or in their case, a lot of things a little bit too long, but for them, all of these things are so important. And what you see when you watch the show is that people will have tears in their eyes and they will be screaming and crying when these people come try to help them to remove these things in their life. And sometimes it's something like an empty 2-liter bottle. But we would laugh, and that's why this is an entire show that we laugh at. How could you hold on to these things? But before we laugh and before we judge, I want us to look at ourselves tonight, because I believe if we're talking about fixing our focus, some of us are holding on to some junk. Some of us are holding on to some things in our life that people can look at, like small group leader, our friends, or people at school can look at. Similarly, how we look at the people in the show and say, why are you holding on to that junk? Why are you still carrying that trash in your life? And so tonight we're going to talk about fixing our focus on a new life. So we may not be hoarders, but we sometimes have a tendency to hold on to things a little longer. So my question for you tonight is, do you find yourself tonight holding on to sin that needs to be thrown away? And I know that word sin is a little heavy, and it can sometimes or oftentimes hold a lot of weight in our life. But if I can be real with you guys tonight, I want to talk about this because it's so pivotal for you to understand, even at a young age, what your relationship to sin should be. Because if we follow Jesus, we make that decision, he gives us a new life. You don't have to carry the junk in your life anymore. Ephesians 4:22-24 tells us to throw off our old sinful nature and our former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception, and instead to let the Spirit renew your thoughts and your actions. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. So as a Christian, we see in this scripture that God has called us to have a new nature. A new nature, what this tells me is that when we make a decision to follow Jesus, that something about our life should change. But more than that, everything about our life should change. And what this scripture is not saying is that, hey, if you really know Jesus, then you'll be perfect. It's not saying, hey, if you know Jesus, then you'll never struggle in your life. It's not saying that. What it's telling us is that there's a make sure that we pick up. We have to let down the nature that we once had. That's what we once struggled picture is a character that changes because of Jesus. Can I tell you that your character will change when you decide to throw off the sinful patterns of your life? And the reason that this is so important and the reason that we need to talk about this tough subject tonight is because there's a generation, your generation, my generation, that has bought into the lie that we can somehow have a relationship with Jesus and a life with Jesus and still hold on to our relationship and our lifestyle with the world. And I want to tell you, as we see revealed through Scripture, that that simply cannot happen. That a genuine, true, real relationship with Jesus cannot coexist simultaneously with a life that is ruled by our sinful nature. The Scripture tells us that there's a change that must happen in our hearts, but also outwardly in our lives. So I want to talk to you about fixing your focus on the new life. Because I can tell you, you cannot have both, because Jesus requires a commitment. I use this illustration often because in Scripture we see Scripture tells us about the kind of mirrors our relationship between a man and his wife or a bride and a groom. Oftentimes Scripture will use this to describe our relationship between God and the church or God and his people or God and you is supposed to look like. And I say this because my habits had to change, not even before I got married, but when I decided that I was going to be in a relationship. So before I was in a relationship, I would go through talking stages. And when you go through a talking stage when you're single, it's okay to hang out with the boys whenever you want to, right? It's okay to text and talk to different people, and maybe it's okay to talk to different girls. I would recommend it, but how many of you know that when you make a decision, the girls are like, when a guy says, hey, you need to be my girlfriend, he can't text all the girls anymore, right? Amen, right? Guys, how many of you know that whenever that happens with a girl, when someone has to make a commitment to you, they can't hang out with the guys like they used to hang out, right? This is pretty normal in relationships because we understand that when there's a commitment, when we take that next step and we say, hey, you're going to commit, you know it's pretty, but when you get my girlfriend, when you get my boyfriend question, we understand that that has a way. We understand that we would all say, hey, I want that person in a relationship to make a change in things. How many of you have looked at a marriage and someone where you hang out with someone of the opposite sex all the time and do things like they were still single? You would probably question that relationship and the validity of that just a little bit. Why? Because within our very souls, there's something that says there's something different about a commitment. The things in our life should change. And can I tell you that your relationship with God is the same way? You can't say, Jesus, I'm going to give you my everything, and your life looks the same. There's a commitment, there's a change, there's a shift, there's a new nature that Scripture calls us to. And can I tell you that as I look at this and think about it, a lot of times people talk about marriage and relationships as a chain, or it's something that holds you back, or something that puts you in a cage. And can I tell you something for you? Getting married in marriage is the most beautiful thing ever. It's one of the greatest gifts outside of my salvation. It's the greatest gift that God has ever given me. And one thing that I've learned in this commitment is that she actually makes me a better man. Like, God makes me a better man. The Holy Spirit allows me to be a better man. But in relationship with her, God will use her and speak through her. And I can tell you that I'm a better man today than I was tomorrow. I'm a better man today than I was 7 years ago because of my decision with this commitment. And I can tell you that instead of viewing your relationship with God as a fallen sin, if you view it as freedom and opportunity for growth, if you fix your focus on this new life instead of the old life, then everything will change for you. Colossians 3, we're going to read Scripture today. It gives us a little bit of a few examples. It says, to put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you, have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is like also worshiping the things of this world. And because of these sins, the anger of God is coming. You used to do these things when your life was still part of this world, but now it is time to get rid of anger, rage, lust, behavior, slander, and dirty language. Do not lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old sinful nature and all your wickedness. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. So Scripture shows us the reality of what a sinful, earthly nature within ourselves looks like. If you read the Scripture, you see so many examples. First of what a sinful nature looks like.
what Scripture shows us is that it's almost at least we are enslaved to sin before we meet Jesus. But when we encounter Jesus, when we give him our life, when we invite him into our heart and allow him to be our Savior and our Lord, he breaks the chain of sin that once held us. Again, not that we'll never struggle, not that we're not perfect, but your nature is not turned towards sin. Your nature is not turned towards him. He will begin to show you and give you different feelings to the Holy Spirit. And this thing that I'm doing doesn't feel right. Like, these habits that I had before that I could just do and go home and go to sleep, and like, now they'll even be up to me. Now I have this feeling inside that just feels like, hey, this is wrong. This is not how I should be living my life. But we also see an encouragement here that it doesn't matter where you are in your past life. Of sin, because when Jesus comes into your life, what matters now is who he's called you to be, who he's calling you to live in your life. So tonight we're going to set our focus on the new nature and the new life that Jesus offers. And we can also use this text to ask ourselves the question, am I giving my focus in my life right now to things that are listed in this passage? Because Scripture says to be renewed if we learn to be like our Creator and become like him. So become like him. This means that this is not an instantaneous thing. But whenever we come to Jesus, our salvation is instantaneous. We are saved in that moment, but we are, as Scripture says, being renewed for our entire life. But when we make that decision, we turn onto a new life, and that you become like Christ is an everyday, all day, everyday thing for the rest of your life. I believe that we never truly awake up. We never really get there. And because of that, our heart is to strive to be more like him every single day, knowing that we'll never attain perfection, but we can go to and submit to the one who was perfect and we'll focus on new life. I want to close by telling you a story that we see in Luke 8. It's actually something called a parable, which is just a fancy word for a story that Jesus used when he was talking to his disciples. And he would tell a story, a made-up story, about a real spiritual principle, so that they could understand what he was saying. And so I want to, if you have your Bibles, you can tell me this in Luke 15, verse 7 and 17. This is a story of what Scripture calls the lost son. And this son in this story was the son of the king. He goes to his father, who is the king, and he says, hey, that inheritance, that money that I'm supposed to get whenever you pass away, like, I'm going to take that a little bit early, and I'm going to get that money. So the dad says, cool, I'll let you go, here's the money, go do what you want to do. And the son leaves, and he's taking his story. He wasted away all of his money on sinful things. He wasted away all his money, all his time, and he found himself, because of the life that he lived, homeless. More than that, he was in the midst of animals, he was dirty, and was even at this place in his life where he's homeless, he has nowhere to go, he's actually eating the leftover food that the animals have. He's with the pigs, he's with the dirty animals in the mud, digging on the trough, eating the leftover food. This is a guy that grew up in the king's palace, his dad was a king, he had all, everything he could ever want in the world, and he gave it up for something. He gave it up for leftovers. And this is where we pick up his story. It says, when he finally came into his senses, he said to himself, the whole man of my own servants have food and with despair, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, Father, I have sinned against the Lord, and here I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me as a hired servant. So he returned home to his father, and while he was still a long way off, his father said, come. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, Father, I have sinned against the heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. Have you ever had a moment to sense this moment? Have you ever had a moment where you look up in your life and you realize this is not what I thought life was going to look like? This mess that I've put myself in, this is not what I thought life should look like. We see this young son come to this realization in his life, and I wonder if some of you tonight need to realize where you are. You need to look at your life and realize that this fun life you thought that you could live on your own is not very fun at all, and that you're living in a slump, you're living in a leftovers, you're living in something that God has not called you to live in. But also, just like the son, you know where to turn to in the midst of darkness. See, the son knew in his worst case scenario, where he found himself himself a new way to become the same. Romans 6:4 says, we die and we were buried with Christ. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we may also live new life. You have access to a new life tonight. You have access to a new nature, a new call, a new life that God has called you to. But ask yourself tonight, if you had a moment where your life went from the old life to the new life, can you look at your life and pinpoint a time where you would say, that's the moment I gave my life to Jesus, and I know that everything changed? Can I say that with you?
Thank you.
Jesus.